Hello siblings, welcome back to my channel. If you guys are new, make sure you hit subscribe and turn on post notifications. Today we have a very intense video, but I think it is going to be super helpful. I'm gonna try to stay on the positive side of things and just talk about my own personal experiences, not get too crazy in depth with anything. So I actually already made part two. It's already edited up and ready to go. I just have to publish it. But after thinking for a while, which is why I didn't publish it right away, I decided to wait and make a part one first, just talking more about like the emotional side of why I left the Mormon church, just more of my personal experiences rather than the in-depth causes that made me leave the church, because those can be very sensitive topics. And I think this will help a lot of people better understand just like where I'm coming from emotionally before I really dive into the other one, because I don't want people who aren't ready for that information to not be able to know my story. So this is kind of part one of why I left the Mormon church, why I'm not Mormon anymore. Anyway, so I was born into a Mormon family. My dad's side, super Mormon. My mom's side, they're not Mormon. My mom was actually a convert, and my mom actually became inactive when my parents got a divorce when I was like six. So already I don't have that typical Mormon family. I come from divorced parents. And then my dad gets remarried when I'm like 10, so I'm in a blended family. It's a little different than your typical Mormon family. But I'm a multi-generational Mormon, grew up Mormon, all that. So my whole life, I had a pretty solid testimony of like God, of Jesus, just the very, very basics. I was baptized when I was 8, that's just kind of like the norm, what happens. Nothing too crazy. I always had some questions, but when I was younger, I was way too focused on just like having fun, being young, my friends. Like, I wasn't really thinking too much about religion or, you know, anything like that. It was whatever. I kind of thought I knew everything about Mormonism and what I stood for. And honestly, I kind of had a superior complex, which a lot of Mormons have, and I talk about this more in part two. But it's just, we have the truth, you don't. Even other churches who are like Christian churches, we even think like they just don't quite have it all. They all have a piece, but we have the whole thing. The Book of Mormon ties it all together. The church is known as the restored gospel of Jesus Christ. So Joseph Smith had this vision. He saw God and Jesus, depending on which version of the first vision you read. And he started the restored gospel of Jesus Christ, which is very different than the gospel that Christians follow. So keep that in mind. So a lot of Mormons do have this like superior complex. So I kind of like always had a slight testimony of God. When I was about 17, that was like for sure, like that became like knowledge to me. But I never got a confirmation after reading the Book of Mormon or going to Mormon churches, anything like that. It was never the Mormon church is true. All I knew is like God exists, basically. So I was kind of just going off of that. But growing up, I always thought if God is real, it has to be the Mormon church because we have the whole truth. No other church has it. So it was not an option to believe in God and not be Mormon in my head. So also when I was 17, I got my patriarchal blessing. If you don't know what this is, basically you meet with the stake patriarch. He does a little interview with you. He gives you a blessing. This blessing is supposed to be like directly from God. It's your guidance in life. Mine was like one page, super basic. I've read a couple other people's patriarchal blessings and it is almost identical to theirs. Literally nothing special. The only special part in it is it says I'm talented in arts and theater or something like that. But that's because of my interview beforehand. I literally told them what I do for a living and everything. After receiving my patriarchal blessing, it literally meant nothing to me pretty much from the day I got it, because I was like, okay, like I could have told myself this. So that was kind of not reassuring. So I graduated high school when I was early. When I was 17, I moved to Utah. I didn't really want to go to church. I honestly kind of wanted to be inactive, but my cousin kind of dragged me to church. And at the time, I wasn't like, I don't want to go, I don't believe. It was just kind of like, I didn't know where I was at. And so I went. But I really didn't feel like I fit in. Like, first of all, I was the youngest person in the singles ward. I was 17. Obviously, Utah Mormons are very different from like Midwestern Mormons or pretty much anywhere else. I do remember hearing this story and I was so inspired by it in a negative way. Negative, as the church would probably say. This girl was talking about how she went inactive for like a whole year and she did all the things you're not supposed to do, and then she decided to come back to the church. And I heard that and I was like, man, that sounds great. Like, I wish there was something to push me to be inactive so I could just leave and come back, no big deal, I'll repent, and then I can be Mormon. Because I did want to be Mormon, but I just didn't know what I believed, and I wanted to go be a normal 17, 18 year old. I just got out of the house. Like, I just want to go live my life and not worry about it. I was kind of at the point where like a lot of Mormons will say, oh, ex-Mormons leave the church to sin. And that's kind of where I was. Like, I wanted to do those things I never was able to do. It wasn't really anything to do with anything else. It was a really immature view at the time, but I decided not to become an active. Like, it just wasn't an option. Like, my whole family was Mormon. I grew up thinking this is the only truth. Like, it wasn't a belief system for me. It was my life. I was a Mormon. It was my identity. It was not an option to leave. But I'd still go. I mean, I'd miss a Sunday here and there, go out to eat on Sundays here and there. I got my second piercing. I wore whatever clothes I wanted. Like, I finally decided, like, I can do me, and, like, me and God are cool. Like, it's between me and him. No one else needs to intervene. That's what I thought. Continuing. So my ex at the time was on a mission for the church. The guys or girls will go serve. And it is pressured, and I mean pressured, that guys go on missions as soon as they turn 18. So my ex was on his mission and he was struggling, and I'm not here to tell his story at all. Don't ask me questions about him, where he's at. Quite frankly, I don't know. He was really struggling on his mission, and we were writing each other pretty much every day, which you're not supposed to do, but we found a way. And he wanted to come home really, really bad. And I had this huge pressure from my family to not let him come home. That would be him being a bad example to our future kids, and, you know, and then people have speculation, like, well, are you guys worthy, and, like, all this stuff. Anyways, blah, blah, blah. Fast forward. Then we've been dating for, like, a while, and there was always pressure to get married because that's the most important thing, and that's what's drilled into your head starting from when you're, like, a little kid, is the most important thing is that you just get married quickly as possible and start a family. Mormonism is all about family, which I'll get into why that actually becomes a problem. Nothing against family. Love family. Nothing against getting married or having kids. Like, I want that one day. But it's just the pressure to do it right away. Like, and this is when I started to kind of question things. I was like, hold up, wait, does this make sense? I kind of always had questions, but it wasn't really affecting my life. Like, I was a kid. Like, I followed the rules of church because they were the rules at my house. Like, it was whatever. Like, yeah, I had questions, but there is a saying, doubt your doubts before you doubt your faith. Like, just put it on the back burner, don't worry about, which is what I did. I put it on my shelf. And that's why a lot of people say, what broke your shelf? I'll get into that. So yeah, we decided to get engaged in October 2019. And at this point, I already had so many questions, but we were planning on getting married in the temple. That was something I always thought I wanted, at least. And there wasn't really another choice. So, like, yeah, we're gonna get married in the temple. We had all our bishop interviews, blah, blah. We got married like 3 months later. But right before you get married, either before you go on a mission or before you get married, you get in doubt. And this is where I kind of want to talk about something I've been hearing a lot about on, like, the Mormon Stories podcast, is informed consent. So they ask you, you receive consent if you want to go through with this, but it's not informed consent. And a lot of people even say that getting baptized into the church isn't informed consent, because if you look at this from an outside perspective of, because when you're Mormon, you look at it as the church is true, you start there. But from an outside perspective, you start at nothing. You don't think the church is true. So from that outside perspective, Mormonism is a high demand religion. There is no getting around that. And when you're entering into a high demand religion, you should be receiving informed consent. These are the rules you're gonna have to follow. This is what is expected of you. If you want to make it into the temple, into the celestial kingdom, which is the highest kingdom of heaven, these are what you're gonna have to do. You don't really receive that. Also, getting your endowment, you don't receive informed consent. They send you through a class called Temple Prep where you learn absolutely nothing about what you're gonna be doing in the temple. I had the opportunity, my dad sat me down and explained it a lot more in depth, which I appreciate, but it still does not even compare to what actually happens. So you go, you first go through an initiatory. I'm not gonna, like, get into everything here. That's where you, like, start wearing your garments, which are underwear that's like a shirt and long shorts that go to your knees. They're white. Pretty much if you're a Mormon, you've been endowed, you wear these. And you're supposed to wear them 24/7. I've had a lot of people be like, oh, you're not forced to do anything. You don't have to wear them 24/7. But I'm going off the church handbook, or, like, what I was told on my endowment day. Like, if you're following Mormonism to a T, you should be wearing them 24/7, except for swimming, things that you can't wear them in. You also get a new name, which I didn't think that big of a deal. I thought it was really weird. Why are they giving me a new name? Doesn't make any sense. But I learned now, being out of Mormonism, how a lot of high demand religions, there's another name for it, but I won't go into that. They give you a new name because they're trying to strip you of your identity. Like, we don't need Sydney. We need, this is your new name. But you don't tell your name to anyone except your husband on your wedding day. But you don't ever get to know his. Little sexist in my opinion. Okay, so you get endowed. The first thing they do in your endowment is you're all there, boys on one side, girls on the other, and they say, like, if you want to leave, you can. Like, do you want to do this? So there's your consent. You stay. It's not informed consent. You have no idea what you're about to be wearing, what you're about to be doing, what you're about to actually be committing to. It's intense. And I talk way more about this in part two, and I really don't want to go into depth here. But basically, after leaving that, I was like, I'm going to get to the bottom of this because that was weird. And if this isn't true, I'm not going to keep doing that because that's weird. This is why they say you should be spiritually ready when you go get your endowment. But the thing is, for me, and people have a problem with me saying forced, but I was forced into it. Because if you want to get married in the temple, you have to get endowed. If you want to make it to the highest kingdom of heaven, the celestial kingdom, you have to be endowed, you have to be sealed in the temple. So it's not forced, but it's this or you don't get eternal salvation. So yeah, got endowed, got married, hated my wedding at the temple. Also, same situation. I had so many questions after. So this is when I kind of started digging into it. And after going through the temple, I decided I'm not wearing my garments anymore. I hate them, everything about them. I think it's stupid. If I'm wearing them for other people and not for God, it's disrespectful anyways. So I stopped wearing them. People know if you're wearing them or not. It's very obvious. You can feel it. You can see the markings. So yeah, people found out and started asking questions. And the thing is, like, one of the temple questions is like, do you sustain the prophets and apostles as seer, revelators, prophets and apostles of God, basically saying like, do you know that these people speak for God? And I was at that point like, there's no way, because God would not do this. Like, just all these different things that prophets have said throughout history that I won't get into right now. So then I actually start learning about just boneless Christianity. Like, I just said boneless. What was Christianity? Because I was always taught as a Mormon, I was Christian. Christianity is very different than Mormonism. Very different. And I loved what I was learning about Christianity. I loved it. It sounded so welcoming, so simple, so easy. It's just about you and God. It's about your relationship with God. It's about accepting Jesus' sacrifice. And like, that's it, basically. There were all these rules and things and da 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 da. Anyways, I'm gonna get into some things that actually really bothered me. And basically, these are more of the less like doctrine-based, history-based reasons I left, which is kind of the main reason I left. That's a part two. I'm just talking about more just basic, simple things that made me want to leave. So one is going through people to get to God. Now, Mormons will deny this. They say, no, we have a relationship with God. But if you really mess up, you have to confess to your bishop and he decides what your punishment is. He decides what's next for you. He's the one who gets to decide if you go up to the temple. He's the one who gets to ask you very personal questions, questions about your sexual history, questions about what you're eating, drinking, what underwear you're wearing, because you have to wear garments. A religion that controls your underwear. That should be red flag number one. anyways, so you go through your bishop or you go through your stake president. You also follow the prophet who claims to speak for God. That is not going directly to God. It's going through the prophet, through your bishop. So although they do say you can pray straight to God, obviously people have prayers, personal revelation, it's not 100% just you and God. You can't make it to the celestial kingdom without the church. It's not just you and God, it's you, the church, and God. So that gets into another point that I have, is that Mormons believe in the church, not in God. And yes, they will say they believe in God, but when it all comes down to it, they're serving the church. Everyone talks about the church. Everyone who gives their testimony in church or speaks in church or talks about the church in general to people, even the prophets, the apostles say this. It's not, we love God. I know God is real. I've accepted Jesus. It's the church is true. The Book of Mormon is true. I trust my leaders. I believe in the prophet. I believe in the apostles. It's not I believe in God. It's I believe in the church. And I've struggled with this for so long. And then when I went to just like a normal Christian church and not a Mormon church, they didn't once talk about the church. They didn't once talk about the building they were in. The pastor didn't talk about himself. Like, it was just God, Jesus, God, Jesus. But in the Mormon church, it's the church, the bishop, the stake president, the prophets. Follow what the prophet says. And I hate to call out my dad here, but this was one big thing that literally pushed me away, was I was asking a bunch of questions about garments, about the word of wisdom, all this stuff. And he said to me, follow the prophet blindly because he knows the way. That's actually a primary song. Follow the prophet, follow the prophet, follow the prophet because he knows the way. Sorry, I'm tone deaf. Anyways, so that's like conditioned in your brain since you're like a little kid. Like, follow the prophet, he speaks for God, he knows the way. And when I was told follow him blindly, that was a a huge wake-up call because I just realized that's what Mormons do. They just listen to the prophet. And prophets have said very controversial, very hurtful things in the past. And they don't apologize for it, they just move on. And as someone who's speaking for God, if they mess up and they're talking of man and not for God, which is a whole nother issue, they should apologize for that and say, sorry, that was a moment of weakness. I was talking as man, not as a prophet of God. But they don't. They just push it under the rug, move on with the next thing. So here's another huge one for me, and I talk about this in part two. A lot of Mormonism is about being alone with an old man. From the time you were 12, you are alone in a room with a bishop talking about your sins. And I find it especially concerning the whole like sexual sin part of this, because that's a very uncomfortable thing. And a lot of bishops have abused this power. I'm not saying all of them, I'm not saying all bishops are bad. There are great bishops out there. I had some good bishops, never was in an uncomfortable position, but there are way too many stories about it. Think about it like this, from an outside perspective. Would you want your 12-year-old daughter in a room alone with a 45-plus-year-old talking about her sins, talking about her sexuality, talking about what she's eating, what she's drinking, what she's thinking about, all these intense things, because these are the temple questions. So to get a temple recommend, they have to talk about these things with their bishop. And it goes on. This goes on forever. You're always meeting alone with your bishop. Like if I was still in the church right now, I would be meeting with my bishop. And people just think, oh, well, they're bishops. They're chosen by God. We totally trust them. Well, there's a lot of bishops who have, I mean, I don't even want to say. It's bad. It's really bad. So we'll move on from that. So another thing and a huge problem I've seen as someone who has a huge Mormon family is families are first, right? It's taught families are forever, families come first, family's most important, except that's not the truth. The church comes first and then the family. The amount of times that Sundays are supposed to be, you go to church and then you spend time with your family. The amount of times that church activities went above my family activities, the amount of times family members have chosen going to a church event over something that was important for me, the amount of times family has pushed away other family members because they don't believe in the church and chosen the church over family, that's concerning. Very concerning. But choosing a church, an organization, a religion over your own children, family members, cousins, aunts, friends, whatever it is, that's a problem. I've been on both sides of the conversation. Now being an ex-Mormon, I've been on the conversation of you'll never be happy outside the church, yada, yada, yada. When I was Mormon, I was on the side of the conversation as my mom, my brothers, whoever it was, they're all being disobedient, they'll never be happy. Hearing what people say about the members of my family who weren't in the church makes me really sad, and now I know I'm probably the topic of discussion because I'm not in the church, and they all went like quietly. I have not gone quietly. I make TikToks, YouTube videos, I'm very vocal about things because I want people who are in the situation to have someone to go to. The amount of DMs I've gotten leaving the church versus being in the church is way, way, way higher because people are hurt and people are alone. People are literally having to leave their families because they are shunning them and pushing them out for not wanting to accept the church. And then I have to be there for them. And the ex-Mormon community has to be there to pick them up and say, it's okay, you can be happy. So basically what I wrote down here was families and Mormonism are number one until that family isn't Mormon, until that family member stops going to church. It's just how it is. So they make you think it's all about families, but it's really all about the church. Another thing is that a lot of Mormon members defend wrong actions, just straight up. And I won't get into what a lot of those wrong actions are, but defending Joseph Smith marrying 14-year-olds, defending polygamy, defending racism, defending sexism by saying, oh, well, times were different. Oh, well, we don't really know everything. Like God knows it all, whatever it is. Defending wrong actions, just straight up blatantly. But if from an outside perspective, like that is not okay. And the thing is, the church never apologized for it. And Mormons say, it was different back then. We've learned, we've grown, we've moved on. But there was never an apology. There was never an explanation. It's all excuses, excuses, excuses. And that's also concerning to me. I already touched on it a little bit, but prophets can say whatever they want and everyone in the church will believe them. The church is worth over $100 billion. They have stocks, they have investments, they have property. They're a rich church and they still ask for 10% of all their members' income. But they're powerful. They have money. They can throw money into property. They can throw money into making movies and pushing out content, and they have all these millions of people ready to listen to whatever the prophet says. Prophet can say whatever he wants. People will believe him. That's dangerous. I was listening to a podcast that talked about any man who claims to speak for God has too much power. It's true. Your relationship with God should be one-on-one. It should not be through a person, even if that person claims to be a prophet, because that can lead to lots of manipulation. If you are claiming to speak for God for someone else, that is too much power. Another thing is like the church. This is another really, really big one, is that the Mormon church is a church of works. You earn your place in heaven. You earn that eternal salvation. There is a checklist of things you have to do, and you have to continue to keep these covenants that you make in order to make it to heaven. That is not how God is. You cannot earn more of God's love. It's already there. You can't earn more. It's about faith. It's all about faith. And that's something I've learned converting to Christianity, is it's just about faith in your relationship and accepting Jesus. It's not about how many covenants you've made, if you're making like oaths in the temple, if you're wearing certain clothes, certain underwear, all these things. It's not about that. It's just not. And the Mormon church, they use works as a way to control you. Because if you're unhappy in the church, they just say you're not doing enough. You're not doing all the work. So if you did all the works, you'd be happy. But that's just not the truth, because you can't earn more of God's love. So another big thing in the church that I really didn't even know about. So there's these things called disciplinary councils. They might be called something different now. But basically, you meet one-on-one with multiple old men, and they get to determine your worth. Isn't that great? They look at all your past sins. And if you didn't know, the Mormon church actually keeps a record of your sins. So each bishop you go to can read up on what your past sins were. So much for your sins being washed away. Anyway, so if you go to a disciplinary council, often they will ask you about your sins from way back before, even if you've already repented from them. And then they judge you based on your whole story, because you committed a big sin. And then they can decide to punish you. Some of the things they can do is disfellowship you, which means you can't take the sacrament on Sunday, so you're being publicly humiliated because everyone in the ward can see that you're not taking the sacrament. You grab the tray and you pass it, you don't take it, so that's public, you know. You can't pray, you can't give talks, so two more like public things that you can't do and that people can judge you for and clearly find out that you've been disfellowshipped. You don't have a temple recommend. And then the other thing is you can actually get excommunicated. And I think a church that can excommunicate you has too much power, because you can't be excommunicated from God's love. It just doesn't make sense. So excommunication is anything that has to do with you being in the church is taken away. Baptisms, covenants, temple, whatever, taken away. It's basically like you were never a member. You're no longer a member of the church. You can go to a church building. You cannot participate in sacrament, anything like that. You can't go to the temple. You're no longer a member. You would have to get rebaptized. Just think about that for a minute. If you cannot get into the temple and you don't do all of your covenants, you won't make it to the celestial kingdom, which is where God lives. That's where you can reach exaltation. That's the highest of high points in Mormonism after you die. So if you can't do all these things, you can't have eternal salvation, which is the goal. And so when they excommunicate you, they basically take away your eternal salvation, according to Mormonism. So that's just concerning to me, when really God loves you no matter what. So, from what I've learned, like, there is no checklist. There is no earning more of God's love. There is no kingdoms of heaven. It's just insane how much power the Mormon church has over people and how they can really get in people's heads by just drilling this into their head. And another thing I wrote down is false promises. They promise that you can make it into heaven no matter what kind of person you are. Your whole family can make it to heaven. You can all make it together. You can be sealed together. Families are forever. All these false promises that just... They're not even in the Bible. Where are they coming from? Probably the Book of Mormon. Backing up Mormonism with more Mormonism. That's the best way to do it. And so yeah, a big thing for me is that your sin should be between you and God. If you messed up, you and God can work it out. If you feel really bad about something, you and God can work it out. And that's between you and God. I do not need to know. No random old man needs to know. But in Mormonism, a bishop does need to know, or a stake president does need to know. It's not between you and God. And the last thing, the biggest thing, and how they really get to you is basically by telling you, if you have a good feeling, it's the spirit talking to you. It's God. So that's just concerning, because your emotions can be altered by putting you in certain situations. And that's just not how it works. And that's how they control you, through your feelings and through making, basically they set the bar, and then if you don't meet that bar, they save you. That's what the church does. It's like, hey, you have to, here's all these sins you can't commit, right? Okay, you committed them. Okay, you're unworthy. You are, well, there's so many analogies. That's dirty water, wilted flower. You are not that. But we can save you. We'll put you on a disciplinary council and we won't give you that harsh of a punishment. We won't excommunicate you. And then you're so thankful to the church because they didn't do that, right? So it's just, it's a cycle over and over and over. I think the thing that's just, and this video is supposed to be all about emotion. I didn't even get into the doctrine. I didn't even get into the history, which is just so, This is just plain what's in my head. The biggest thing to me is that Mormonism belittles God. They believe you can become a God. They believe God once was a person who came from another God, and then he exalted into becoming a God. And that right there is just crazy to me. They also don't believe that Jesus was God. And it's just a very, very different theology. Is that the right word? And yet they claim to be the same as Christians. So that's just really difficult. It is a very high demand religion, but they claim to be the only one, the true of all. So you don't see it as high demand, you just see it as that's the way God has it to be. What I'm trying to say here, and what I'll wrap up with before you can watch part two, is that there is life outside of Mormonism. You can be happy outside of Mormonism. You can have a relationship with God outside of Mormonism. My relationship with God has never been better. I've never been happier. I'm finally to a point in my life where I don't want to unalive myself, and I have not felt like that in a long time. People who are Mormon are gonna get mad at me for saying this, but God 100,000% led me to where I am today. He has been trying to get me out of the Mormon church for so long. I can look back and just see so many instances where he was just dropping a little hint, trying to guide me, trying to help me, and you know, I just didn't get it yet. I wasn't ready. And when I was finally ready, he freaking hit me in the face with a brick. That was a weird analogy, but I'm so happy now. And God has led me to here. I've left the Mormon church. I'm no longer a member. I'm not associated with Mormonism whatsoever. Another thing is, like, if you are Mormon and you're watching this, I have nothing against you. I'm here with open, loving arms, no matter what your beliefs are. If you have questions, I'll answer them. If you have a different opinion, that's totally fine. I'm just here to share my experience. So part two will be coming who knows when. I go very, very into depth about growing up Mormon, the pressures of Mormonism, the culture of Mormonism, the doctrine, the history, the difference between Mormonism and Christianity, what I believe now, where I'm going next. All of that will be in part two. And I tried to make this one short and it still ended up being so long. So I'm probably gonna have to make even more parts. It's dark, I'm on my phone, it's bad quality, but I wanted to add this. I wanted to add that the biggest thing, especially because this video is supposed to be about my emotions, is leaving Mormonism is not easy. I wanted it to be true. I like begged myself to believe in it. I wanted it to be true so, so, so bad. I wasn't looking for wrong. I wasn't looking to just leave and go sin. I wanted it to be true. And when I found out it wasn't, it was life changing. It was earth shattering. It broke me. I was never more depressed than I was at that time when I decided I needed to leave the Mormon church. It was really, really hard. And that's the main reason that I'm posting all of this. It's gonna offend family members. It's gonna offend friends, other Mormons, Mormon followers, some of you guys maybe. It is worth it to help save one other person who is 100% alone, who has been kicked out by their family, who has been shunned by who they thought that they were their friends, who feels alone and defeated. And especially if I can help people not give up on God altogether, that would be great. It's hard. It is not an easy thing. I don't want people to think, oh, well, you left, now you're all mad, or you left and you're just doing all this for views. That's not what this is about. I've gone through my angry phase and all of that. I've already gone through it. This is for helping other people. It is the most sad, lonely thing in the world, finding out that your whole belief system, your whole life was a lie. So that's why I'm here. I made a Discord, an ex-Mormon Discord. I will put it down below, a community where people can really open up and share their experiences. Anyways, that'll be in the description. DM me on Instagram, like whatever it is, I'm trying to help. Anyways, thank you guys for watching. I'll see you in the next one. Bye.